You know, smartphones are great and obviously work the best if they have good reception, so that you can, for example, use the internet on the go. That is why products that supposedly enhance this reception have been around pretty much forever. But doing the opposite is apparently also super popular, by creating a jammer circuit that blocks your phone's reception. I mean, this video here from the Creative Science YouTube channel about building a jammer has over 5 million views. His 4G jammer video has 800,000 views, and its signal booster video almost 2 million views. Those are some crazy numbers that my channel can hardly compete with. So that must mean his circuits are truly brilliant and functional, right? Well, we will find out in this video, because I will be trying out his jammer and booster design. And at the end, I will give you a wonderful list what he did right and what he did wrong. Let's get started! This video is sponsored by Skillshare. More about them later. Before we get started, I have to state that using a jammer, and thus blocking other people's signals, is not legal in most countries. But don't worry about that if you want to build these jammers, because they simply do not work. Before getting to that conclusion though, I firstly recreated the schematic given by the Creative Science channel for its first jammer design. And while doing that, I ran into my first problem. You see, this intersection here does not come with a dot. The dot would mean these components are all connected. Which would make sense, because you don't want this resistor voltage divider floating in the air without having its voltage applied somewhere. So you might be thinking, okay, just add the dot everywhere. But that does also not work, because here, this intersection dot would short pin 6 and 7 of the 555 timer. And that does not make any sense either. So long story short, I had to make my own dots according to my electronics knowledge, meaning beginners would already be left out here. But anyway, as soon as my schematic was done, I wanted to start off with creating the three coils for the circuit. In the video, he uses 24 AWG wire, which, according to the internet, has an outer diameter of around 0.51 mm. The closest copper wire I got laying around though comes with 0.65 mm, which is actually not a problem, because when looking at the thickness of the wire in the video, then I think I'm pretty close here, and he's actually using thicker wire. With that out of the way, I wound the three required air coils and finally moved on to recreating his circuit on a piece of perf board. At this point, I actually had nothing to complain about, because, you know, there is not much that can go wrong when following a schematic to create a circuit. So after around 1 hour, I inserted the main IC, hooked up the transistor, and gave it all power. And after placing my smartphone next to it, nothing really happened with its signal strength and thus reception. I mean, if this circuit would be a jammer, then this value would have to decrease if I turn it on. But it does not, no matter whether I use 5G, 4G, 3G, or even 2G. So what is going on here? Well, first off, a phone jammer circuit basically spits out radio frequency waves, whose frequencies are around the same our phone uses, and thus it gets more or less confused and cannot send or receive data successfully. Now over the years, different mobile network technologies got introduced, currently going from 1G to 5G, which all use different frequencies. But it is quite obvious that most of them use rather high frequencies in the gigahertz range, meaning our jammer circuit needs to be able to create such frequencies. And when looking at the schematic, and in combination with some basic electronics knowledge, it is quite obvious that it cannot do that. By the way, you can of course gather such knowledge when watching my electronics basics video series. But you can also extend your knowledge by checking out Skillshare. They have lots of different classes when it comes to electronics, meaning you can easily identify such fake circuits. What I love about their classes is that you can learn from other makers. You can always find a class that suits your skill level and it keeps track of where you left off, which is really convenient. And don't worry, there are tons of classes about other topics as well, like programming, Arduino, doing animations, and much, much more. Especially for me as a video creator, I also do enjoy their video production classes, of which I recently checked out Advanced Video Editing with Adobe Premiere Pro, which gave me some really good tips. And now that we're in summer, take this time as an opportunity to explore your creativity and invest in yourself by taking a Skillshare class. The first 500 people to join using the link in the description get a 1 month free trial of Skillshare. And with that being said, what does this DIY jammer circuit do here? Well, first off, we got a 555 timer here in an A-stable configuration. That means, depending on the two resistor values here and this capacitor, it spits out a square wave with a specific frequency. To make our life easier, we can use an online 555 timer calculator, and after punching in the values, we get a frequency of 2.5 MHz, which is not even close to the phone frequencies. And even worse, after probing the 555 timer output with the oscilloscope, it seems to only output around 620 kHz. The reason is that such NE 555 timer are not made for such high frequencies. But you know, in theory, that should not be a problem, because this square wave only triggers this transistor here, which lets current flow through this LC tank circuit. This one basically lets current oscillate between the capacitor and inductor, which happens at a resonance frequency that we can also calculate. Only problem is that measuring the inductance value of an air coil is not so easy to do. So instead, let's have a peek at the schematic of Creative's channel follow-up 4G Jammer, where he simply uses inductances. By using those, we get a frequency of around 500 to 800 MHz, which is closer to what we need. But if we measure practically, then we can only see a teeny tiny oscillation happening, with around 7 MHz. So yeah, neither is the practically achievable frequency high enough, nor will the power outputs of this flimsy trimmer capacitor be able to interfere with anything. And no, adjusting the trimmer capacitor does also not change much. But I will give it that by using my tiny spectrum analyzer here, which in a nutshell can detect the radio frequency waves around us, this jammer does emit some spikes in the 125 MHz range and multiples. And like mentioned before, there's also a 4G jammer version, which more or less only uses a different transistor and plays around with capacitor values to reach a higher frequency, which, like stated before, is not possible with the NE555 timer. But I was too deep at this point anyway, and thus decided to try it out as well, and pretty much as expected, we got no jammer functionality and the emitted waves were also quite a bit less. And to give you a comparison, here's a circuit that truly operates at 2.4 GHz, which includes shielded casing and perfectly calculated wire traces. Yeah, when doing radio frequency electronics, you basically enter another world of black magic. But anyway, last but not least, I recreated the schematic from his phone booster circuit, and pretty much like before, started out by creating the coils and then the whole circuit. And after powering it up, it pretty much does nothing with the signal strength of my phone, and also emits pretty much no RF waves. This circuit is also way dumber and easier to expose. I mean, just look at the input antenna side. Here, a BF195 transistor is supposed to react or amplify the phone's RF signal. Only problem is that the transistor caps out at around 200 MHz, which is way too low. And there are tons more problems and mistakes in this circuit. But to summarize, here are the good things I think about the Creative Science phone circuits, and here are the bad things. You be the judge whether I'm too harsh here or not. So all in all, I'm pretty disappointed. And I hate to see that this exact same 555 phone jammer circuit is everywhere on YouTube. So what do you think? Should I expose more videos and channels like this? Or should I simply ignore them? Let me know. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed this video and maybe learned something new. If so, don't forget to like, share, subscribe, and hit the notification bell. Stay creative, and I will see you next time!